Get here early. 877.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash. Good afternoon.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my.
To quote a popular lyric, Johnny Cash was a little bit country and a little bit rock and roll. He had a voice that seemed to come from the bottom of a well of pain and passion. And with more than 50 million records sold, his appeal crossed generations and cultures. In 1982, the late Harry Reasoner caught up with the man in black for 60 Minutes. That interview turned out to be one of the most revealing Cash would ever give.
Kill anyone.
Coming up right now, that interview updated with new footage on 60 Minutes Uncut. I'm Steve Croft.
I was trying to tell what life was like, just trying to exist.
At the time Harry Reasoner first sat down with the man in black at his Nashville home in 1982, Cash had been an established star for three decades and led a life that gave him plenty to sing about and plenty to say.
So smile pretty.
You wrote a book about yourself. I'd like to read you a couple paragraphs. Sometimes when I'm on stage now, feeling so good, feeling so strong, sometimes right in the middle of a song,
I find it very
my mind will flash back 8 or 10 years to other times when I sang the same song, but with a frenzy, frightened because I knew my audience could tell I wasn't right. I'd slur the words, I'd miss a word, I'd try to smile, but the nervous twitch in my face kept the smile from coming. Sweat would be pouring out of me, a throat parts dry from amphetamines and cigarettes. And then you go on. I was actually so far gone, 1966 or 67, that I attempted to burglarize drugstores to get a large supply of drugs. I became paranoid. If I saw a police car, I'd duck down a side street, then drive like mad through residential areas, narrowly missing innocent pedestrians. Why I didn't kill anyone, I don't know. Or maybe I do know. Must have been pretty hard.
It was. I was trying to describe the hell of trying to stay alive under such conditions, strung out on amphetamines and barbiturates. You see, it's a vicious cycle. The amphetamines to get me up, the barbiturates to bring me down. And in concert, when I started drinking in beer along with the amphetamines, I'd drink about four or five a night, but I got up to 12, 14, or a case a night. And I would take it to the concert with me. I want to get just about that high off the ground before I'd go on stage. Sometime I'd misjudge how high I was, you know? And I'd get on stage and I was a wreck.
The Grand Ole Opry banned you at one time, didn't it?
Well, I don't know how bad they wanted me in the first place, but the night I broke all the lights on the stage with the microphone stand, they said they couldn't use me anymore. So I left and used that as an excuse to really get wild, and I wound up in the hospital with my third time I broke my nose.
At the time, Cash was married to Vivian Liberto and had four daughters. But Cash was the first to admit he wasn't much of a husband or a father.
You can't raise children on amphetamines and barbiturates and alcohol. And so the family, the wife and the family pulled away from me, and I pulled away from them. It just happened. I can't blame it on anything else except the death-dealing things that I was into.
What was the absolute low point?
The absolute lowest point was just before the turnaround in 1967, when I was down near Chattanooga, Tennessee, in my Jeep, and I decided that I could never face anybody again. I had gone back on my word with everybody so many times and hurt them and lied to them that I thought I'd just crawl off in a cave and die.
This lady has been the biggest hit in my life for the last 20 years. Ladies and gentlemen, June Carter Cash.
If any one person could be credited for turning Johnny Cash's life around, it was his second wife, June Carter Cash.
We got married in a fever on a van of the first round.
She began performing with her mother, Maybelle Carter, and her sisters when she was a kid. When they met, Johnny Cash was a big star, and June was on her way as a Grand Ole Opry regular. John asked June to join his tour, and what she joined was a nightmare in progress.
I really was afraid that it was going to kill him because he was losing weight. It was getting worse and getting worse, and so I guess I decided if he fires me, he's going to fire me, okay? I'm going to fight it if I have to. I would go and I'd say, John, you don't need this medicine, you know. Please try, throw it away, and let's get this tour done. Sometimes he would throw it away. Most of the time he would hide it.
The only person who would really know how I suffered would be June Carter. And she suffered along with me and fought it with me.
I became a thief. I stole pills. I stole hotel keys. I did everything that I could, and I did things that I would have never done ordinarily, but I think I did it only because I didn't know what else to do. I thought he would die. And so I flushed things down the commode. I flushed down his amphetamines and his barbiturates, which was what he was taking at the time.
Did she ever give up on you or feel like giving up on you?
Well, she said a couple of times that she was going to, but she never did. No. She's not the kind that would give up on anything she believes in.
At the time, battles against addiction were kept quiet. When Elvis Presley died, the nation was stunned. It was shocked to learn the tragic details, the cycle of pills that ate away at his life.
When he died, did you think there but for the grace of God in the hands of the Lord?
Mm-hmm. I sure did. A lot of us did. We talked about it.
They started out together, young men who walked in off the street to the same recording studio in Memphis back in the mid-1950s. Shown here with Elvis, that's Jerry Lee Lewis on the left, and Johnny Cash on the far right.
There's so many that started back in the mid-50s that are gone now, but there but for the grace of God goes me. There were people that had been supplying me that didn't want to see me straighten up, you know. They'd written me off. I mean, some prominent people in the music industry that wanted me to go down with them. But my friends and loved ones kept them away. I locked myself in my bedroom out here on Old Hickory Lake, the house that I bought. I was living there alone, and I climbed the walls for about 30 days.
When you were on the pills, did you think you were a better singer because of them?
Oh, I thought I was invincible. I thought I was indestructible.
But you're better now.
I broke a lot of bones, yeah. I feel a lot better now. I feel a lot better about my performing, the whole thing. I'm 50 years old, and I feel like life has really just begun for me.
When we come back, the road to stardom, from picking cotton to picking guitar.
We wish you a happy Honda Day. We wish you a happy Honda Day. We wish you a happy Honda Day for a happier new year.
It's Happy Honda Days, the perfect time to treat yourself to the restyled new Accord, the all-new fuel-efficient Civic, or any one of Honda's lineup of 2006 cars and trucks. Make your holiday wishes come true at your Honda dealer today.
Happy Honda Day.
Beat the crowds. Shop Kmart all day Thanksgiving. Store-wide savings, Thursday only at Kmart.
You kiss a scrape to make it better. You do a little dance to make the tears stop. You've learned a million things to help your little one. Like what?
Selling most requested song, one I wrote in 1956.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line.
Johnny Cash was an established icon of American music in 1982 when the late Harry Reasoner spoke with him for 60 Minutes. By then, Cash had already been inducted into the Country Music Hall of Fame. The Rock and Roll Hall of Fame would come 10 years later.
The songs you've written, what's your favorite, Johnny?
Well, I think I'd probably should say I Walked the Line because it was my biggest seller. But the one that really means more to me, that says it more for me in my life, I think is Picking Time. The message of the song is good times coming for us all, at picking time.
Would you sing it?
I just happen to have a guitar. I got cotton in the bottom land. It's up and growing, and I got a good stand. My good wife and them kids of mine, gonna get new shoes come picking time. Get new shoes come picking time. Every night when I go to bed, I thank the Lord that my kids are fed. They live on beans 8 days and nine, but I'll get them fat come picking time. Get them fat come picking time.
The song was inspired by his memories of growing up on a cotton farm in Dias, Arkansas. As one of seven children born to a sharecropper during the Depression, Cash was used to working 12-hour days in the fields.
We came back home from a flood in 1937 when I was 5 years old. It ran us out of our home. And my mother always said that when we have a hard time of adversity, that if we look for it and we're committed to the Lord, He'll send us a blessing. And there it was out on the cotton fields, about 8 inches of rich black river dirt. And the next year, we had the best picking time we ever had.
When did you decide you could probably make a living singing?
When I was about 14 years old, and my mother encouraged me to sing. And I picked cotton, chopped cotton, but you could hear me all over the country singing in the field.
Tenor then, right?
Tenor.
That's right.
When I was 17 years old, my voice had dropped. My mama said, "Who was that?" And I said, "That was me." And I was singing, "Everybody gonna have religion and glory. Everybody gonna be a singing a story." And she came over to me and put her arms, hands on my shoulder and said, "The Lord's got his hand on you, son."
When did you start to make a living? What were your first professional experiences?
Really, the first big deal for me was I was guest on Elvis Presley's show at Overton Park Shell in 1955 in Memphis. And then I went on tour with Elvis for several tours.
Did you like him?
Oh, yeah. Elvis was a great person.
Elvis and Cash represented a new style of music that was a combination of rock and roll and country. It would eventually become popular, but in the beginning, it was too radical for Nashville.
They rejected us in Nashville, you know. In 1955, when I came out, I was one of those Memphis long-haired rockabillies, man. They didn't want me on the Grand Ole Opry.
I hear the train a-coming, it's rolling around the bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom Prison.
That all changed when Cash's career took off with the overnight sensation, Folsom Prison Blues.
To tell you the truth, I wrote Folsom Prison Blues in 1954 after I saw a movie called Inside the Walls of Folsom Prison. And the people have told me there's some of the most realistic and believable lines in the world in that song. A guy singing the line like, "I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die." Sounds like he's got to be mean, you know.
But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die.
Because of those grim lines, a popular myth grew up around Cash that something dark and awful in his past had inspired him to sing so convincingly about being stuck in Folsom Prison.
What were you in prison for and how long?
I was in there to do an album, but I never served time in prison. I've never been convicted of a felony. I did gain a certain notoriety back in the early 60s for about 7 years, actually. I'd find myself in a county or city jail.
Like a drunk tank kind of thing.
Right. I needed to be in jail at the time, yeah.
Some of your songs are like Pickin' Time. They're inspirational. They reflect kind of a spiritual life. Some of them are pretty low down and dirty, like Folsom Blues and so on. Do you have any trouble reconciling the two kinds?
No. Roy Orbison had a line in a song called My Best Friend, and then it was a line that says, "A diamond is a diamond and a stone is a stone, but man is part good and part bad." You know, I recognize the fact that I'm part good and part bad.
But the best part of him, Cash would say, was his family man. Together, June and Johnny Cash had a son, John Carter Cash, and they doted on him. Young John went on tour whenever school permitted, and sometimes when it didn't.
Is John Carter going to inherit the black uniform and the guitar?
No, he doesn't like black.
He likes country music, though.
Oh, yes, he does. Mm-hmm. He writes it, too. He started to write it.
They come out.
Although Cash was a doting father to young John, his older children hadn't gotten the same attention when they were young.
He was gone a lot, and we missed having a father when we were little.
In the late 70s, that relationship improved.
You're reconciled with the girls now.
Oh, yeah. I have a great relationship with my daughters. Roseanne's doing great.
Roseanne later followed in her father's footsteps. She became a second-generation Grammy winner and enjoyed her father's support on stage and off.
I'm trying so hard to spend more time with Roseanne and the other girls.
You hot, huh? Need some cool water? There's some right down there.
Next, Johnny at home, and the Cash family cashes in.
Two platinum-selling artists whose paths have crossed before. Together for the first time in concert, CMT Crossroads.
Don't take your love to town.
CMT Crossroads with Lionel Richie and Kenny Rogers. Saturday at 8, 7 Central. Brought to you by Old Navy.
Did you find?
One night stands were Cash's bread and butter. When 60 Minutes went on tour with him, he couldn't really afford to stop. The fans who bought the records and watched the TV shows expected it. The musicians and the technicians who traveled with him expected it. It did have its rewards, a minimum of $35,000 a night. Altogether, Johnny was earning about $5 million a year, but it could be tedious. 110 times a year, some reporter would ask him,
how many concerts do you do a year?
About 110, which puts us on the road about 200 days a year.
It's amazing that you are in such good physical shape, then.
Well, maybe that's what keeps me going. I love it.
The picture you got of Johnny Cash from his music was that of a man alone. Nothing could be further from the truth. Not only did Johnny have plenty of company, he was a company. This was Cashville in every sense of the word.
We have John's book over here for sale, and he'll sign it for you.
What Harry saw in 1982 was a nice little family business. Johnny's mom was at the store near the Cash home in Nashville every day. Johnny and June came by on occasion on special fan days. June's sister, Anita, also worked there. Fans could pay their money and take their choice, a T-shirt or an autographed book. Mama Cash's down-home cookbook. They could even take their picture in front of a picture or in front of the real thing. And for $2.50, brother Roy Cash would usher you into the Johnny Cash Museum to see the gold records and the memorabilia that went back to when Johnny was a boy in Dyess, Arkansas.
If it's something they really want to see, they'll save their money for it.
Upstairs, Sister Reba in the red outfit ran Johnny's business affairs, which included banking, a piece of a truck distributorship, and a good deal of undeveloped land. In a town where guitar-shaped swimming pools were the norm, Johnny and June's lavish lifestyle borrowed more from European royalty than country chic.
This is Czechoslovakian, right?
When we visited June, one of her daughters by a previous marriage, and her sister, Anita, were preparing for a tag sale to unload some of the crystal that she had no more room for.
I hate to see it go. When it starts turning...
Clearly what June unloaded wouldn't be missed. A dozen or so rooms, including twin formal dining rooms, were crammed with chests full of crystal and silver and china and antique furniture. Not bad for the son of an Arkansas cotton farmer.
All these animals got names, Johnny?
Well, this, John Carter's named most of them. The donkey's named Jack, and this is Donnie. And, that's Marie.
I'm giving up.
He was a gentleman, the Johnny Cash we met, and shy. And with an armed security force, an elaborate system of fences and gates, he managed to create an oasis of privacy for himself and his family in the country music fishbowl that Nashville had become. He lived on his own 50-acre wildlife preserve, As he told reporters, he loved taking walks and gardening and working outdoors.
Are you having trouble?
Yeah, I try to take care of myself. I take exercise, I work out, I walk, and I swim, and I have a garden. I work outside. I love the outdoors. Mm-hmm. I get plenty of exercise. As far as I know, I'm in perfect health.
But in the late 1980s, life on the road began to take its toll on the aging star. Johnny had heart disease and a string of other illnesses. Although he still drew big crowds on tour, few people were buying his records. And after a while, his record label dropped him. Then, just when it looked like his career was grinding to a halt, it was given a jolt by the most unlikely music producer, founder of Def Jam Records, Rick Rubin. Together, they launched a Johnny Cash revival. A new generation became Johnny Cash fans. For the first time in 20 years, he was winning Grammy Awards. And in 1999, Cash was awarded the prestigious Lifetime Achievement Grammy.
I don't know what all that means, you know, living legend. Maybe it means I'm a survivor. I am that, I guess. And that my peers would pay this tribute to me just is wonderful.
His last big hit was called Hurt, written by the group Nine Inch Nails. It's a haunting reflection on regret, mortality, and loss.
What have I become? My sweetest friend. Everyone I know goes away in the end.
In retrospect, the song seems like a eulogy because within months of its release, June Carter Cash died.
My daddy has lost his dearest companion, his musical counterpart, his soulmate, and his best friend.
Johnny Cash carried on as best he could without June, but he succumbed to complications of diabetes 4 months later and passed away. The man in black was gone, but he had left behind a towering musical legacy. And even at the end, he remained creative. In 2003, he was posthumously awarded Country Music Awards for the best album and the best single of the year.
Away.